بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Respected brothers, elders, mothers, sisters, and youngsters, I begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, the sustainer, the most high, the benevolent, the merciful. And I send the choicest salutations upon our beloved messenger, Muhammadul Mustafa wa Ahmadul Mujtaba, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevate his status and may he keep us close to him on the day of judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran, He lays out the blueprint for us of how we are to go about living our lives. He tells us what to do, He tells us what mentality and attitude we are to have. And He tells us that, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ That He has contained within the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the perfect example of how we should mold and craft our lives according to. Who was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? There are many things said about him. Here's a little poem that I wrote. In fact, someone close to me wrote and sent it to me. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant her Jannatul Firdaus. When people talk about reputation, imitation, and those worth emulation, I instantly think about a man I once heard about. A man others don't doubt. They say he was sent to not just the nation, but to the whole of creation. He's the man they say upon whom came the final revelation. The man who with God held the deepest of relation, the closest of connection, without even a direct conversation. The man who exceeded all borders of perfection with no limitation. The man who never failed to bring in clarification in the face of contradiction. The man who held the purest of intention from amongst all of civilization. The man who never sought attention or even took under consideration to gain recognition. The man whose introspection holds no comparison. After much thought and contemplation, they've considered him a rare exception. The man who came to grant our generation divine liberation. The man who came to teach humanity rules and regulations and the act of unification. The man who came to do justification for countless accusations. The man who came to guide us through trials and tribulations. The man who came to clean up misconceptions and eliminate deceptions. The man who came to abolish corruption, segregation, discrimination, and to put straight confusion and complications. The man who was sent to make corrections by teaching redemption for all the imperfections. The man whom if you'd met, you'd never be able to bear the thought of separation. His mission, his obligation was only propagation to help us attain salvation in our final destination. So his nights were spent in supplication, while his days were spent in contemplation. And his only plea was, Ummati, Ummati, my nation, my nation. This very man asked for nothing but for us to turn before we return. This very man is who I can consider worth emulation and worth imitation. This man is none other than Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. So if there's anyone that's worth imitating and emulating or holding as an influence in our lives, we know very well that it is the one that was chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the person who was chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to carry the very sacred message of La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. When we look into the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we'll find evidence of this fact that he is the one that's worth imitating and worth emulating. If you just simply take the time to look over what kind of a person he was, a family man. If you look at how he conducted himself in the society, how he behaved with his own family, you'll realize and accept right away that definitely if there's someone that I should mold my life according to, it's the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one very familiar incident from his life was when he was given the task of carrying the message to the nation of Taif. It was a time in his life when he had just recently lost his sense of support in the home in the form of Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. And he also just recently lost his sense of support in the society, the one who protected him from being killed, his uncle, the Abu Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So he was carrying this grief. At that time Allah instructed him to go to the people of Ta'if. When he comes to the leaders, they reject and they deny him. We know very well the story that not only did they reject him, they instructed the people in the society to pelt him with rocks and torment and traumatize him. And they hit him to the extent where his blood started flowing from his head and his shoes were clotted with that blood. Right? He says at that time, look at the selflessness of this great man, that despite having every right to exact his revenge upon these people, or to even hold ill feelings towards these people because of the way that he treated them, he went to them with no strings attached. All he wanted was for them to get Jannatul Firdaus and to be safe from Jahannam. When the angel, he says to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha afterwards, recalling this incident, that there is one day that was even more difficult for me than the day of Uhud. And he says that after I was rejected, I came, the only place I could relax was when I found a tree where I sat down near, I looked up, there was a cloud. Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam was sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He came with the angel of the mountain. Jibreel says to me that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has heard the reply of the people and their response to you when you gave them the message. And he says that he has instructed the angel of the mountains. The angel of the mountain greets the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He says to him that ask for what you wish. If you want, I will crush the people of Taif between these two mountains. The selflessness of this man, that at that moment where he must be feeling the most down and full of sorrow and grief and feeling that pain physically from the difficulty that they caused him, he instead not only forgives them, but he prays for them in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying that if not them, then somewhere down the line in their progeny, they will accept Islam. Right? What is it that makes a person or allows a person to have this sort of conduct and behavior? It is the nur of iman. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam carried iman in his heart. He not only proclaimed it, but he manifested it in the form of his practices, his conduct and his behavior. Right? Our understanding of what iman is for someone to proclaim la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, and he is within the folds of Islam. When you look in the Quran and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, it takes a different approach to describing and defining who a Muslim is. In the hadith, for example, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, "Akmalu al-mu'minina imanan ahsanuhum khuluqan wa khiyarukum khiyarukum linisa'ihim." This is a hadith of Tirmidhi which he graded as Hasan Sahih, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says that the person with the most perfect iman from amongst the believers is that person whose behavior is the most excellent, whose conduct and character is the most excellent. And the best of you are those who are the best towards your wives. In other words, your conduct, the way that you treat other human beings, first and foremost your family, and then to an extension your society, and then to people whether you know them or not, that is a manifestation and that is showing that you are a true Muslim. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, "Al-Muslimu man salim al-Muslimuna bilisanihi wa yadi." That a Muslim, the definition of a Muslim, is that person from whom people feel safe from his tongue and his hands. In other words, a Muslim is one that never harms anyone with his words or physically with his actions. Right, that is the definition of a Muslim. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, "Al-mu'minu man aminahu an-nasu 'ala dima'ihim wa amwalihim." That a believer is one from whom people feel that their lives and their wealth is safe. In other words, a Muslim, a believer is one who never even considers corrupting another person's wealth or harming another person's life in any way. That is the definition of a believer, right? So in another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, "Al-mu'minuna hayyinuna layyinuna kal jamal al-anif in qida in qada wa in unikha ala sakhratin istanakha." In this hadith, which is a narration of Tirmidhi by tariqa irsal, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says that the qualities And the mentality of a believer is such that they are soft, they are gentle, they are kind, they are affectionate, they are loving, they are not aggressive, and they are ones that cause trouble to other people in the society. And he gives the example that in terms of fulfilling their obligations and their rights to Allah and their rights to the people, they are such that they are like a camel who's tied by the nose, that whichever way you pull it, it will go. And if you were to put it on and tie it to a rock, it will stay there on that rock. Right? So when we fulfill our light, when we're fulfilling the divine kalima that we take with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we're fulfilling that, when we're fulfilling our obligations, we do not show hesitation or irritation. In fact, when there are times that by fulfilling the obligations it causes us difficulty in some way, Muslims are those that have patience and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the point I'm trying to draw home is that it's not enough that we just say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. The definition and the description, in fact, the very definition of a believer in the hadith is one who has good conduct and good behavior. So good conduct, good behavior, and the way that we present ourselves is of such importance that it's assumed the very definition of us as believers. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Al-mu'minu ma'lafun aw mu'lafun, wa la khayra fi man la ya'lafu wa la yu'laf." That a believer, his nature is that he's friendly and he's very kind. And that person who has no goodness within him and is not friendly or does not enjoy friendliness, that person has no goodness within him, says the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That this should be our priority, that we mold our lives in a way that we're actually defining what a believer is through our actions. Because a non-believer does not get his information from the Quran or the Hadith. They get their information from viewing us. Right? They get their information from interacting with us. And the way that we conduct ourselves is the Quran, is the Hadith, is the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, alhamdulillah, may Allah bless them and may Allah grant them Jannatul Firdaus and be pleased with them. They were ones that had this type of mentality always. Consistently. What is that quality and those noble traits? Some of them are mentioned in the hadith, which I will mention. In one hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Idha sarratka hasanatuk wa sa'atka sayyatuk fa anta mu'min." Another definition of who a believer is that when doing something good, it brings you joy, it brings you happiness, it gives you a thrill. That is a sign that you're a believer. It's not just that you're reading namaz because you've been doing it for so long as a ritual or habitually. Right? Rather, every time you do something, you understand that this might be the one action that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judges my entire life according to. And in the same way, when doing something wrong, وَسَاءَتْكَ سَيِّئَتُكَ, right? That when you do something wrong, it causes wavers in your soul. It makes you restless. It gives you insomnia that I have done something on this earth that has displeased the Creator, the Sustainer, and He might very well judge my entire life according to this one action. If you build this fikr, this mentality, this eagerness that was in the companions, then you'll see that you'll be successful in life. Right? But we've all done wrong as human beings. We make mistakes. As long as you have breath and you're still living, you have the ability to make up for those mistakes in many ways. In one hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Ala adullukum ala ma yamhu Allahu bihi al-khataya wa yarfa'u bihi ad-darajat." Should I not tell you of some actions with which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala erases your sin, not only forgives them but completely erases them, and then He elevates your status. Number one, and these are very simple actions, but it's up to us to hold these simple actions with great gravity and hold them with such importance like the Sahaba did. One action is isbaghul wudu'i ala al-makari, to make wudu perfectly in the manner in which was taught by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the same method even at times when it's difficult. One example of this is when it's winter and you don't have access to hot water, it may be difficult to make wudu. But at that moment, you understand that it's still my obligations necessary for me to touch the Quran and read Salah. So therefore, you do it anyways. This action will be rewarded, one, for making the wudu, and then for that difficulty that you endured, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, without even you raising your hands and asking for it, He will erase your sins and He will start to elevate your status. That's one simple action. May Allah give us the ability to act upon it. Another action, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, kathratul khuta ila al-masajid, that to take excessive steps towards the masajid. It means to frequent the masjid as much as you can to fulfill your obligations and other things. And if possible, to walk towards the masjid. For every step that you take towards the masjid, a reward is written in the court of Allah. And after we die, the currency that we're accumulating over here, it won't have no value, it won't help us. Only these actions and these simple things that we took the time to actually, you know, consider as important and then act upon it are the things that will have any value in the hereafter. And the third thing, this is very important, وَانْتِضَارُ الصَّلَاةِ بَعْدَ الصَّلَاةِ. It's such a simple action that you don't even have to do anything. It's literally just waiting passionately after one salah for the next salah. And to wait passionately, all of us human beings know, we all are attracted towards something. We all are consumed by something in our lives. For some people, it's how to get more wealth. It's the stock market. For some people, it's, for example, for younger people, it's sports. Right? When they have a favorite team, they'll wait for months. Or they'll wait 60 days before and they'll count down the days, 59 days till the season begins, 54, 30, 10. And then when the season starts, you end up losing all the games and you have a first round exit. So all that waiting was for nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if you wait passionately after one salah, you ask for forgiveness that you may have not read that salah properly, and then you wait that, oh Allah, give me one more opportunity that I read salah perfectly, that if I die, that you accept this salah from me and you judge my life according to it. That waiting that you did in between that, that is a way of erasing all of your sins and raising your darajat, raising your status in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? This was the mentality of the Sahaba. That they were so eager, every chance and opportunity they got, they would go to the Prophet, let me learn something new. Let me learn another simple action that we do daily, but that it's a reward from Allah so that I can make intention that Allah is going to reward me for it. So, for example, Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he once was talking to Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he narrated to him the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that a person who follows the janazah, performs the janazah salah, that person, and then follows the janazah afterwards, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him in reward one qirat. And then, if a person, after following the janazah, stays for the burial process and helps in burying the deceased in some way, يَرْجِعُ بِقِيرَاتَيْنِ وَكُلُّ قِيرَاتٍ مِثْلُ أُحُدٍ. The Prophet ﷺ said that that person will return with two qirat, and every single one qirat is equivalent to the mountain Uhud in reward in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just for doing that simple action. Abdullah ibn Umar, when he heard this, he immediately went to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala to confirm if the Prophet ﷺ said this. She said, yes, definitely the Prophet ﷺ did say this. What was his reaction to this? He said, لَقَدْ ضَيَّعْنَا قِيرَاتًا كَثِيرًا. That definitely we have missed out on many opportunities, many qirat. So he actually showed some remorse and grief, not over something that he did wrong, but for just missing an opportunity and securing a different avenue to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have this mentality. We're always looking for different avenues and different opportunities to gain wealth, for example, right? How can I get another job? How can I get another business where I can secure another form of income? There's nothing wrong with that. But as believers, first and foremost, our priority should always be, how can I secure another avenue to get closer to Allah, to save myself from Jahannam, to save myself from the punishment in the grave, right? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he told the Sahaba about the slaughtering the animals, they asked right away, مَالَنَا فِيهَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. What is our reward in that, O Prophet of Allah? The Prophet ﷺ said, بِكُلِّ شَعْرَةٍ حَسَنَةً. For every hair, you will be given a reward, every hair on that animal. SubhanAllah, the companions were so greedy for good, for doing good, they said, وَصُوفْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. What about wool? Right, even though it was already there, the Prophet ﷺ said, وَبِكُلِّ شَعْرَةٍ مِنَ الصُوفْ حَسَنَةً. That even from wool, every single piece of wool, there will be a reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was telling them about the the coming of Dajjal and the events before, prior to Qiyamah. He said one thing, that yawmun kassana, that one day will be like 1 year. Subhanallah, the first reaction of the Sahaba and the companions was, in that day do we perform only 5 salah, or are we allowed to perform the salah for an entire year so that we could secure more reward and help ourselves in the akhirah even more? Right? In Bayhaqi, there is one narration. So these are just simple actions that we learn from the hadith that we could easily do and prepare ourselves for the akhirah, accumulate more and more value that will help us in our grave and in the akhirah. So in Bayhaqi, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's one hadith, man nadhara ila walidayhi nadhra rahmatin kataba Allahu lahu bi kulli nadrin hajjan mabrura. That person who simply looks at their parents with a gaze of affection and mercy, not even obeys the parents, not even fulfills the rights of the parents, just simply looks at them with happiness and a gaze of mercy, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will write for that person the reward of one accepted hajj. Right? How easy an action it is just to look at your parents with love. Right? But we don't understand this. We don't understand the value of these simple actions, and we should very quickly, because this life is very short. Right? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he passed away more than 1400 years ago. They're waiting in the grave. We live for 60, 70 years. The day of judgment itself is 50,000 years, as mentioned in the Quran. When you compare the life that we live to the time that we will be staying in the grave before Qiyamah, and then to the day of judgment itself, it's nothing. We don't have time. Time is the currency. So we have to take this time to do good. And in fact, the Sahaba were so greedy, again, about building this mentality, that when the Prophet ﷺ said this, that if you look at your parents just with one affectionate gaze, you get Hajj Mabrur, they asked, وَإِنْ نَظَرْنَاهُمْ فِي يَوْمٍ مِئَةَ مَرَّةٍ. What if we look at them 100 times in one day? And the Prophet ﷺ said, Allahu Akbar wa Atib, there is no shortage in the treasures and the rewards that come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more the better. So what did they respond? They said, إِذَنْ نَسْتَغْفِرْ. That then, if that's the case, then we'll do it excessively. We'll do it. And evidence shows, history shows, that these simple actions, the Sahaba, they did do it consistently and excessively. May Allah also give us the ability. Right? So the Sahaba were ones that when it came to good, they were always eager to do more. They were always eager to find another one good thing that they could do. And when it came to things that were wrong and evil and considered filthy, it would cause them much sorrow. In fact, that would cause them much sorrow, but even missing out on opportunities would cause them immense grief and sorrow. One evidence of this is presented by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself in the Quran. Right? That when it was the time of the Battle of Tabuk, it is mentioned on the last page of the 10th juz in the Quran. وَلَا عَلَى الَّذِينَ إِذَا مَا أَتَوْكَ لِتَحْمِلَهُمْ قُلْتُ لَا أَجِدُ مَا أَحْمِلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ. That Abu Musa Ash'ari's Jama'at, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were preparing for battle, and at that time, to go out into battle, you would need a conveyance, you would need material, you would need goods and artillery, etc., etc. They came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to ask if they had this, because they didn't have it themselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when they came to you, O Prophet, so that you may give them something that they could ride, that they could carry their goods on, the Prophet replied by saying, I don't have anything left to give you guys, therefore you can't come with us. Allah records their reaction to this, their grief and their sorrow. He says, تَوَلَّوْا وَأَعْيُنُهُمْ تَفِيضُ مِنَ الدَّمْعِ. That they turned around and their eyes were filled with tears. They were crying profusely. Not just crying, they were crying profusely over the fact that they missed out on this chance to help the Prophet and help the deen and please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. حَزَنًا أَلَّا يَجِدُوا مَا يُنْفِقُونَ. They were very sad and grieving over the fact that they did not find that which they could spend in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? So this was their mentality and their attitude. Right? It's written in the Quran, وَإِنْ قِيلَ لَكُمْ ارْجِعُوا فَارْجِعُوا هُوَ أَزْكَى لَكُمْ. In the commentary of this verse in Ma'arif al-Quran, it is written that when you go to someone's house, a relative, friend, anyone, and you knock and they don't respond, and you turn away without being irritated, you don't even do anything, you just turn away with a clean heart, this is a means of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purifying your heart. And the person that I heard this speech from, a South African scholar, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him, increase his knowledge and grant him and his family's entire community Jannatul Firdaus, He says that he knew of a scholar that for many years went around knocking on his relatives' door and companions' doors just so someone could turn him away and he could leave with a clean heart. Because he says that scholar acted upon every single verse in the Quran that spoke about forgiveness with an exception to this one. So he actually was eager to act upon this virtue that is set by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah, this was the fikr, this was the mentality of the companions, the scholars, and the people that are close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make it possible for all of us. In Siyaru A'lam in Nubala, there is an incident that is recorded about Malik bin Dinar, rahimahullah. So he was a very great scholar. A thief broke into his house one day, robbed from him, steal from him. But obviously, because Malik bin Dinar was such a simple person that was connected with Allah, he had nothing in his house that was of value from mata'i dunya. So he confronted the thief after the thief was helpless. He couldn't find anything in the house. And he tells him, فَلَمْ يَجِدْ شَيْئًا مِنْ مَتَاعِ الدُّنْيَا أَتَرْغَبُ فِي شَيْءٍ مِنَ الْآخِرَةِ. You haven't found anything that is of value to you in the world. Should I tell you of something that may bring value to you in the Akhirah? And then he taught him how to read namaz and made him perform 2 rakat salah. Subhanallah. So this person came to steal from Malik bin Dinar, but Malik bin Dinar stole his heart because of his conduct and his behavior. He didn't scold him or turn him away, right? He actually taught him deen. He manifested his iman, right? And this person was able to read salah. Who knows that it may be that may be the reason why he enters Jannatul Firdaus, and his entire life of good work will now be attributed to Malik bin Dinar as well. So this is something we need to consider very well, my dear brothers and sisters, that these simple things, we should hold it as very, very significant and very, very important. Because the things in this world, if we spend time behind it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already tells us in the Quran, and it's the truth. Al-ma'lu wal-banun zinatul hayati dunya, that the wealth and children, they're just adornments for the things in this world. They don't have no value. وَالْبَاقِيَاتِ الصَّالِحَاتِ خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا. That what's going to be everlasting is your good deeds. And they are better in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we're spending all of our time to just accumulate wealth or to gain power or to gain some sort of recognition and become popular, then you're losing. And you're going to be from the losers in the hereafter. Because Akhirah and Jannah and the rewards in the hereafter are prepared for those people that do not seek recognition, that do not seek power. Allah also says this in the Quran, and it's the truth. تِلْكَ الدَّارُ الْآخِرَةِ, the life of the hereafter. نَجْعَلُهَا لِلَّذِينَ لَا يُرِيدُونَ عُلُوَّ. It's prepared and it's ready for those people that do not seek ulu, that do not seek power, that do not seek status. وَلَا فَسَادَ, and do not cause corruption, right? Because when one person or a group of people come together and fulfill, live that lifestyle and also call people towards that lifestyle of accumulating wealth and becoming more powerful and becoming more recognized, this causes corruption in the society for the more average person and the common man who now thinks that success in life is only through power and wealth. Whereas success is if we follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the perfect example. So my dear brothers and sisters, this Friday, if you get the chance, follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by reading Suratul Kaf. Read at least 1,000 durood upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Read Surah Mulk, right? When we're told that we're going to be saved from the punishment in the grave, if you read Surah Mulk, we say yes, okay, and we maybe read it occasionally. But when we're told that if you read Surah Waqi'ah, for example, and it will increase your wealth, we do this very happily with joy. Right? You're supposed to have this joy and this happiness for every single action that you do. Whether it's a good word spoken or lifting something from the ground or walking towards something, every single thing that you do, it should bring you a thrill. If it brings you a thrill, this is a sign that there is iman in your heart. If it does not bring you a thrill, and this is a sign that your iman needs to be rejuvenated. You need to renew your vows with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then start practicing with sincere intention. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, bless the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, elevate his status. Ya Allah, allow us to recognize his sacrifices. Ya Allah, give us love for the Quran. Ya Allah, give us love for the Hadith. Ya Allah, give us love for the Prophets, the Anbiya, the Tabi'un. Ya Allah, bless the person who wrote this speech. Ya Allah, bless and give us the ability, tawfiq, because we can't do anything without His tawfiq. Right? May Allah give us the tawfiq to do good, to hold every good that we do with significance. فَبِإِنِّي لِمَا أَنزَلْتَ إِلَيَّ مِنْ خَيْرٍ فَقِيرٍ. Whatever good Allah gives us the ability to do, we're really in need of it. We're faqirs, we're muhtaj. We need these things. So may Allah grant us these things. Ameen, 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 ya Rabbal Alameen, bijahi Sayyidil Mursaleen. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillah.
الحمد لله الذي جعل في كر الأيام معتبرا وفي تقلب الزمان مزدجرا. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله، أرسله بالنور والضياء وقدمه في الاصطفاء وجعله قدوة الحنفاء، صلى الله عليه وعلى آل بيته وأهل صحبته وعلى جميع أتباعه وأنصار دعوته، وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى: أفحسبتم أنما خلقناكم عبثا وأنكم إلينا لا ترجعون. فتعالى الله الملك الحق، لا إله إلا هو رب العرش الكريم. عباد الله، إن الوقت هو ضياء الأعمال وضمان مستقبل الأيام، وله تأثير بالغ في بناء حياة الإنسان، كما قال الله عز وجل: والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر. وقال تعالى: أولم نعمركم ما يتذكر فيه من تذكر وجاءكم النذير فذوقوا فما للظالمين من نصير. وجاء في الحديث الشريف عن أبي بكرة رضي الله تعالى عنه أن رجلاً قال: يا رسول الله، أي الناس خير؟ قال: من طال عمره وحسن عمله. قال: فأي الناس شر؟ قال: من طال عمره وساء عمله. وقال سيدنا عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه: ما ندمت على شيء ندمي على يوم غربت فيه الشمس، نقص فيه أجلي، ولم يزد فيه عملي. أيها الإخوة، إن حفظ الأوقات من الضياع من مقتضيات الإيمان، كما جاء في الحديث: من حسن إسلام المرء تركه ما لا يعنيه. ولكن ماذا حالنا أيها الإخوان؟ كم نقتل أقوى أوقاتنا من دون فائدة، وكم نضيع أعمارنا في خرافات وخزعبلات. ألستم تعلمون أن الله تعالى سيحاسبكم على ذلك؟ فقال: وقل اعملوا فسيرى الله عملكم ورسوله والمؤمنون، وستردون إلى عالم الغيب والشهادة فينبئكم بما كنتم تعملون. وكما جاء في الحديث عن سيدنا أبي برزة الأسلمي رضي الله تعالى عنه قال: قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: لا تزول قدم عبد يوم القيامة حتى يسأل عن عمره فيما أفناه، وعن علمه فيما فعل، وعن ماله من أين اكتسبه وفيما أنفقه، وعن جسمه فيما أبلاه. فنصيحتي لكم أيها الإخوان أن تقدروا أعماركم وأيام حياتكم، وأن تستعملوها في أمور الخيرات والأعمال الصالحات، ففي ذلك سر نجاحكم وفلاحكم في الدنيا والآخرة. أقول قولي هذا، وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه، إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد عبده ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى مخبرا وآمرا: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك، وصل على المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات، خصوصا على أمير المؤمنين سيدنا أبي بكر الصديق رضي الله تعالى عنه، وعلى أمير المؤمنين سيدنا عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله تعالى عنه، وعلى أمير المؤمنين سيدنا عثمان بن عفان رضي الله تعالى عنه، وعلى أمير المؤمنين سيدنا علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله تعالى عنه، وعلى سيدة نساء أهل الجنة فاطمة الزهراء رضي الله تعالى عنها، وعلى سيدي شباب أهل الجنة الحسن والحسين رضي الله تعالى عنهما، وعلى الستة الباقية من العشرة المبشرة، وعلى أمهات المؤمنين، وعلى سائر الصحابة والتابعين رضوان الله تعالى عليهم أجمعين. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم انصر من نصر الإسلام والمسلمين، واخذل من خذل الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم اجعل بلاد الإسلام آمنة مطمئنة من كل البليات والآفات. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم، وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم، برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. والحمد لله رب العالمين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروني أذكركم واشكروا لي ولا تكفرون.
الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، حي على الفلاح. قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. فلا أقسم بما تبصرون وما لا تبصرون، إنه لقول رسول كريم، وما هو بقول شاعر، قليلا ما تؤمنون. ولا بقول كاهن قليلا ما تذكرون تنزيل من رب العالمين ولو تقول علينا بعض الأقاويل لأخذنا منه باليمين ثم لقطعنا منه المكذ ثم لقطعنا منه الوتين فما منكم من أحد عنه حاجزين وإنه لتذكرة للمتقين وإنا لنعلم أن منكم مكذبين وإنه لحسرة على الكافرين وإنه لحق اليقين فسبح باسم ربك العظيم
الله أكبر
سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر
سبحان ربي
الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين إن المتقين في ظلال وعيون وفواكه مما يشتهون كلوا واشربوا هنيئا بما كنتم تعملون إنا كذلك نجزي المحسنين ويل يومئذ للمكذبين كلوا وتمتعوا قليلا إنكم مجرمون ويل يومئذ للمكذبين وإذا قيل لهم اركعوا لا يركعون ويل يومئذ للمكذبين فبأي حديث بعده يؤمنون
الله أكبر
سمع الله لمن حمده
الله أكبر
سبحان ربي
الله أكبر
الله أكبر الله أكبر
التحيات
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله سيدنا محمد وآله وأصحابه أجمعين وربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين وربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب وربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم اللهم اغفر لحينا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وصغيرنا وكبيرنا وذكينا وأنثانا اللهم من أحييته منا فأحيه على الإسلام ومن توفيته منا فتوفه على الإيمان يا فاطر السماوات والأرض أنت ولينا في الدنيا والآخرة توفنا مسلمين وألحقنا بالصالحين غير خزايا ولا ندامة ولا مفتونين ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه سيدنا محمد وآله وأصحابه أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.